Good to see you. Good to be in the Lord's house tonight. Page 285. One of the names given to the Lord Jesus, the Lily of the Valley. Page 285. Let's stand. Looky there. You sing a lot better when you stand. Page 285. All right, we're going to have to start off cold, I believe. Here we go. I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see. All I need to cleanse and to make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. Every care on him alone. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 of my soul. He all my griefs takes and all my sorrows born. In temptation he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my idols torn. Blessed will. Oh, all the fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his heat, my soul shall fail. Then a sweeping up to glory, to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. Hallelujah in there. Like I always tell you, Mama used to do that. You could hear her every time. How about the ushers coming? And we'll sing on the last. He'll never, never leave, never forsake. And I thank God for that. While the ushers come, he will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here. While I live by faith and do his blessed will. Oh, all of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he, my hunger, so shall be whole. Then a sweeping of glory, to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright of the morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Ain't that a good old song? Good old song. Pray for us, Brother Fred, would you please?
Thank you. I'm dying for, please.
What I've been given, a life for a life, that's the one I'm dying for. Caught the eye of a man who was beaten, I saw the truth, even I believed him. Now I can't tell from myself who they're wanting more. I hear them cry, release Barabbas. Disbelief, I turned to Jesus.
He looked at me and he said, go free.
Couple weeks, a lot of the team that works for me, works with me, is actually in India, and they've had a lot of stuff going on with their earthquakes and everything lately, you know, and it's a horrible devastation, but the thing that's odd is the guys that are on my team, it's actually some of the things in Nepal that are going on are actually this one guy's homeland, like where he lives. Now he's in a different area, but all he can think about is that he wants to go back to that area and help. It sounds like, you know, it's a courtesy, like he just wants to go help his fellow neighbor, but he thinks that's what he needs to do to get to heaven. You know, that's to get to the afterlife. That was what he was kind of telling me about it. That if you know, the more you do for other people down here, that's what it takes. And so they're all committed to the doing things for each other and making sure I'm just a good guy, and they want everybody to think of them as just a good guy. And you know, I tried to be careful, but. You know, actually adamant, you know, well, I believe what it takes is you have to accept Jesus as your Savior. You know, if you have Jesus in your heart, you want to do things for others. You want to help your neighbor. You want to help your brother because you want to actually show them Jesus through your life. So I would try to explain to him, and of course it's delicate, but you know, if they seem to be receptive, so I'm going to keep throwing it at them. You know, but I want to be an example as much as I can before them, and maybe that's why God has me doing the job I'm doing right now. You know, maybe if I can just touch one of them, we'll see what happens. But pray for me, because I like to try to be an influence on them, and they look up to me right now for work reasons and everything, and so maybe God will give me more opportunities. Thanks.
Take away the troubles weighing heavy on your mind and in your life. If I could, I would wipe away the sorrows that you feel deep down inside and make them right. But there's only just so much a friend wide to stand upon a mountain high. If I could, I would walk across the burning desert sand, restore your soul with sweeter water from a better land. But I'm sure that in my strongest hour, I still could not possess the power to bring you raging fire. You must withstand, but remember Jesus can. If I could, I would wipe away the tears that stain your pillow in the night and make them mine. If I could, I would lift you up above the clouds of doubt in fearful fright with all my might. But the truth remains the same. Though I try my best, I'm still just like you. Thank you.
sky, he heard his cry. He rubbed his eyes with a handful of clay, and he said, go wash in the pool today. And the blind man knew that's what he had to do. I know along the way you couldn't help but trip and fall. Each time he got back up again, wondered if he thought, every step I take is a step of faith. When I can't see what's in front of me, I walk on and just believe. He hears my prayer, and when I'm in there, the miracle promised by my Father is waiting in the water. I've walked in darkness, I won't lie, just like that blind man. Sometimes I felt all alone, like all hope was gone. But I know that his word is true, and no matter what I'm going through, he promised me that he would never leave. I know along the way I may stumble and I may fall, but I'll make it to the water, even if I have to crawl.
Every step I take is a step of faith. When I can't see what's in front of me, I walk on and just believe. He hears my prayer, and when I get there, the miracle promised by my Father is waiting in the water.
I know he knows where I am, and somehow this is in his plan. So until my healing comes, I'll keep pushing on. Every step I take is a step of faith. When I can't see what's in front of me,
I walk on and just believe. He hears my prayer,
for Hannah. I know she is feeling a little dizzy up here, so she did great though, didn't she? Amen. Amen. Acts chapter 18, if you have your Bibles, Acts chapter 18. Let's go ahead and pray. God, we love you, Lord. We thank you for the service. Lord, I pray you'd be with Hannah tonight, Jesus. Just touch her body. She's feeling a little sick. Watch over her. Be with her tonight, God. Be with our church, our school. Just be with us tonight as we share what you've laid on our hearts, we pray. It's in Jesus' name, amen. Tonight, I want to look at a couple who was always moving. They're always on the move. Their names are very familiar to you. One's name is Aquila. Anybody tell me the other name?
Priscilla.
Their names are synonymous with one another. We find them mentioned 6 times in the scriptures. And as you follow them, you're going to find them living in Rome, then living in Corinth, then in Ephesus, and then finally we see them moving back to Rome. So during their life, they made several moves. I thought it interesting, the name Aquila means eagle. The name Priscilla means ancient. I don't know if you'd want to be named ancient. Maybe not. See the elderly people shaking their heads no. Ancient is not a name I guess we'd want to be called. But whenever we read them in the Bible, you'll find they're always together. They're always mentioned. You don't mention one without the other. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us when they became believers in Christ. But when we first meet them here in Acts chapter 18, you're going to see they already bear evidence that they've already been saved. They've already been mature believers, and they're devoted followers of Jesus Christ. So tonight, I want us to get better acquainted with this Christian couple. I want to say three things very briefly, and we'll be finished. First of all, I want you to notice how Aquila and Priscilla were helpful to the men of God. Aren't you thankful for people who are helpful to the men and women of God? In Acts chapter 18, we learn an important and inspiring characteristic about these two. We read how they helped certain men of God in their ministry. Now, I'll say this, through the years, there have been people God has brought into my life, that God has brought into your life, that God has brought into our church's life, that have been big help to all of us in the ministry. That was Aquila and Priscilla. They were those kinds of people. They had a great heart for God's men. And here in Acts chapter 18, we see two different men that they befriended and helped in their ministry. First, we see their encouragement for the Apostle Paul. If you have your Bibles, look in Acts chapter 18. It says in verse number 1, after these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth and found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had commanded all Jews to depart from Rome. And he came unto them, and because he was of the same craft, he abode with them and wrought, for by their occupation they were tent makers. Now, if you know anything about Paul's missionary journeys, you know his second missionary journey had been a very difficult one. It had been very tough on his life. John MacArthur says that the opening of Acts 18 finds Paul at one of the lowest points in all of his ministry. He had experienced riots. He'd been thrown into jail. He had fled persecution on two different occasions. Had in one place experienced a total rejection of the message. Would you be faithful to God's house if someone punched you in the face every time you came? That was the Apostle Paul. His second missionary journey, it had not been without fruit. There were some fruit bare there, but it had come at a great expense. And when he arrived in Corinth, he is no doubt weary in both body and soul. You ever been there before? You're weary, you're tired, you're worn out. And yet, just in the nick of time, God sends the right people just at the right time. And we see that taking place here. It was at his lowest time in his ministry, God brings along into his life this godly couple, Aquila and Priscilla. As we said, they were tent makers by trade. It just so happened this was a trade Paul had learned earlier in his life. See how God's working all this out? They were tent makers. He was a tent maker. I don't know if you know this, but all Jewish boys, even rabbis' sons, were required to learn a trade. And in the providence of God, God had Paul learn the trade of making tents. Now, he probably learned it from his own father. That's usually how it took place. But he's a tent maker as well as Priscilla and Aquila. And as I said, They were from Italy. They had to relocate to Corinth. You're going to Rome, Italy with us. You're going to Greece. We're going to both of these places. We're going to Corinth. We're going to Cenchrea, which is right next to Corinth. We're going over into Athens, which is where they were at. They're going over into Rome, where they were at. But we see that Priscilla and Aquila, they had not been in Corinth very long themselves because they had been kicked out of Rome. The emperor Claudius said, "You either leave or I will persecute you." So they left, and as they arrive in Corinth, they set up a tent-making business, and when Paul arrived from Athens, it was this trade God used to bring them together. So what do? They open up their home to them, and they give them a job. During the week, Paul worked with Aquila and Priscilla. He was a bivocational pastor. He worked during the week, and then look what it says in verse 4. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. So he worked all during the week, making tents. On the weekend, he was a preacher. We find in Romans chapter 16, verse 3, Paul even referred to Aquila and Priscilla as my helpers in Christ Jesus. Now get this, they weren't helping him in making tents. No, that word helper here speaks of being a co-laborer for Jesus Christ. So Paul found in Aquila and Priscilla friends that helped him financially by giving him work, but they helped him more spiritually by being a helper, sharing the message of Christ. We would say Aquila and Priscilla were a breath of spiritual air to the weary man of God. They not only gave him a job, they also brought him joy in the ministry. And I said before, God always knows what we need in our life, and oftentimes he meets those needs by those he sends into our lives. Those precious saints of God, he sends our way, who are spiritual refreshers. That was Aquila and Priscilla. They took him into their lives at a time when he needed someone like them. I don't know about you, but I thank God for people like Aquila and Priscilla. Source of encouragement when we're weary, when we're in need. So we see they were an encouragement of Paul. But notice, secondly, they were also edifying a man by the name of Apollos. See, just as God brought Aquila and Priscilla into the life of Paul at a time that he needed them most, he also brought them into the life of Apollos at a time he needed them most. Look down in verse 26 of Acts chapter 18. Notice what it says. Notice the wording here. It says, "And he, Apollos, began to speak boldly in the synagogue, whom when Aquila and Priscilla had heard, they took him unto them and expounded unto him the way of God more perfectly." Now let me tell you something about Apollos here. Apollos had become a follower of Christ under the ministry of John the Baptist. And I'm telling you, he was at an all-time high later on in his spiritual journey. He was a very popular preacher. You remember Paul said at one time, I preached, Apollos watered, and God gave the increase, or that. Apollos had really made a name for himself. But right now, he's just starting out. He was a skilled preacher. He was a follower of Christ under the ministry of John the Baptist. He was a deep scholar, but there were things about the gospel he didn't understand. He had gotten it wrong. That's where Aquila and Priscilla stepped into his life. The Bible says in verse 26, they heard him preaching boldly in the synagogue. So far, so good. But in verse 25, it says that he taught diligently the things of the Lord. Notice, yet he only knew the baptism of John. Now don't miss that right there. That's very important. What Apollos was preaching was accurate, but he did not have the full knowledge of the gospel. See, he knew the Old Testament scriptures well. One commentary said he had fervor, he had power as he boldly preached in the synagogue, but it all stopped with the baptism of John. How would you feel when I preached on Easter Sunday morning, I stopped at the baptism of John the Baptist? Be pretty sad, wouldn't it? Because when you stop at John the Baptist, that means there was no preaching on the cross. You stop at John the Baptist, there was no preaching on Christ crucified. There was no preaching on Jesus being raised from the dead. There was no preaching on the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. It all stopped at John the Baptist. So this man had zeal, but he lacked spiritual knowledge. So Aquila and Priscilla, hearing him, in love, they take him. And they help him to better understand the wonderful message of the gospel. The Bible says they expounded unto him. That word expounded means they explained the scripture, which tells us they knew what the word of God said. They explained to him, the Bible says, the way of God more perfectly or more accurately. A.T. Robinson said they gave him the fuller story of the life and work of Jesus and filled in the gaps of his theology. But what I find most interesting, and I love this, it's how they approached him. Yeah. Notice they didn't stand up and rebuke him in front of everybody. Right. That wouldn't have done any good. That would have just confused people. Notice they didn't stand up and have an holier-than-thou attitude or a know-it-all attitude. Have you ever met somebody that's got it all together? They approached him in a loving, humble, and thoughtful way. You notice the words in verse 26? Yeah. They took him unto them. That describes how they took him back to their own home. They said, hey, listen, we enjoyed your message today. Why don't you come eat with us? You know, any pastor's not going to turn that down. And when they got him into their home, they lovingly talked to him about what Jesus meant to them and all he had done. And they filled in the missing parts in his theology. And I want you to know, the impact of that dinner changed Apollos forever. I believe he would probably point to that evening as a life-changing moment because Apollos would return to the synagogue to tell all those Jews the rest of the story about Jesus Christ and him crucified. What's amazing to me is this. Apollos had been educated in the finest schools of his day, but God took a simple husband and wife, tent makers, and taught him more than he ever learned in the classroom. When we think about Aquila and Priscilla and how helpful they were to the men of God, we need to ask ourselves if we're the kind of people that bless and benefit others around us. Is there anyone who gives thanks to God for us? Are there others who have been helped by us in the ministry to better know the Lord, to better love the Lord, to better serve the Lord? Aquila and Priscilla, they were helpful to the men of God. But then there's a second thing I see about Aquila and Priscilla. Not only how helpful they were to the men of God, but how faithful they were to the work of God. Another interesting characteristic of these two is that no matter where you find them living, they're serving Jesus. Whether they're living in Rome or Corinth or Ephesus, they were faithful in God's work. I want you to turn forward over to Romans chapter 16. Because in Romans chapter 16, we see them in the next phase of their ministry. And here in this chapter, Paul mentions to Aquila and Priscilla and speaks of their faithfulness in the work of God. And in this chapter, he basically speaks about two things. Number one, he speaks about their service in the work of God. I mean, you know, God needs servants today more than ever. Working for God. Romans 16:3, notice what he writes. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ Jesus. Now, we've already seen that that word helper speaks of how they were companions. Or how they were fellow laborers with Paul in the work of God. And it would seem that from the time they met him, Aquila and Priscilla attached themselves to Paul and worked with him any way they could. Back in Acts 18, verse 18, it says that when Paul left Corinth, he didn't leave alone. It says, I took with me Aquila and Priscilla. And it says, he took this leave of brethren, and I sailed into Syria, and with me, Priscilla and Aquila. See, Paul had found in these two the dearest of friends. They had worked with Paul during his 18 months in Corinth. When it came time for him to leave, they didn't stand on the banks of the shore waving goodbye, going back to their trade. No, you know what they said? Hey, we're packing up our tent and we're following you. We're going to be a part of God's work. Did you know God wants each and every believer to be a part of his work in your own day? We need to ask ourselves, what am I doing for God? How am I serving him? Am I a helper of Jesus Christ? What part are we playing in the plan of the divine architect? Because I want you to know God has a role and a place for every one of us to serve in God's work. Paul was the preacher. Aquila and Priscilla, they were the helpers. And as believers, we're to find our place in God's work. And when we find it, be faithful to that work. Amen? So we see their service. The second thing we see is their sacrifice. In Romans chapter 16 and verse 4, Paul gives us a hint of the depths of the faithfulness Aquila and Priscilla showed him personally. Notice how he speaks of them in verse 4. He says, who have for my life laid down what? Their own necks. I want you to notice, if you mark in your Bible, you want to circle that. These words are only found on this one occasion in the New Testament. You won't find them anywhere else. For my life, they laid down their necks. And that phrase literally means this: to place someone under the axe of executioner. At some point, Aquila and Priscilla had risked their life for the Apostle Paul. No one knows for sure when this happened. Some believe it was when he was in Ephesus and an uproar was caused by a man by the name of Demetrius the silversmith. You can read about it in Acts chapter 19. But the depth of their devotion is seen in that they were not only willing to follow Paul to the ends of the earth, they were also wanting to lay down their lives for the cause of Christ. The Church of Jesus Christ, it's been built on the blood of those who are willing to pay the ultimate price rather than being unfaithful to their Lord. As the early church father Tertullian said, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. How many of you know that we're spoiled today in America? I wonder if suddenly, Sunday morning, terrorist stormed, God forbid, into one of our services and demanded our people renounce your faith in Christ or we'll kill you. How would we respond? I wonder. How many would stand knowing it would mean their life? It seems you can't get most Christians today to be faithful to two services on Sunday. What makes us think they would be faithful when faced with life or death with Jesus Christ? But Aquila and Priscilla, the Bible says they laid down their necks on the executioner's block for the cause of Jesus Christ. And I don't know about you, I have a whole new respect for these two people that I never had before. They were helpful to the men of God. They were faithful in the work of God. Last of all, I want you to notice how careful they were for the church of God. See, a third inspiring characteristic of Aquila and Priscilla has to do with the church. You don't have to turn there, I'll just read it. But in 1 Corinthians 16, verse 19, Paul says, Aquila and Priscilla salute you much in the Lord with the church that is in their house. We also read in Romans 16, verse 5, that as Paul spoke of Aquila and Priscilla, he writes, likewise, greet the church that is in their house. See, we see in their life, the church was an important part of life for Aquila and Priscilla. See, I believe that the church of Jesus Christ will be an important part. Judge the depth of love and devotion to Christ by they were meeting and where they were often the place. They had left Rome years earlier from threats of the emperor, and now they get to come back and they've returned. So what's the first thing they do? They start a church. Think they were afraid of the old emperor? Nah. They wanted to see the believers in Rome and see they had a place to assemble together as the Lord had commanded. So we see Aquila and Priscilla. They were a couple that worked to see a church built in their city. And I say, thank God for people who love the church. Thank God for people who want to build it for the glory of God. Someone has written, there are two classes of people who manifest themselves in every church. Some are constructive, others are destructive. Some are positive, others are negative. And what lacking crew. Crew. If a proposal is made by the board or by an individual, the members of the wrecking crew are on their feet to oppose every measure. He said they're like the deaf brother who used to cup his ear in a business meeting and call out, "Huh? What'd you say? I didn't hear what the brother said, but whatever it is, I'm against it." So we ask ourselves, are we on the construction gang or the wrecking crew? Aquila and Priscilla, they were on the construction game. They were a couple who were building the church. But not only were they building the church, and I close with this, we see in their life, they were blessing the church. It was obvious in all that Paul says about Aquila and Priscilla, they were a blessing to be around in church. No matter where they lived, they were a blessing in that place. They were a blessing to God's people in Corinth. They had to leave Corinth. So then they went over to Ephesus. They were a blessing to the people in Ephesus. They had to leave Ephesus. They went back to Rome. They were a blessing to the people in Rome. No matter who they were around, they were a blessing to those people. And as we have seen, they were a blessing to Paul and Apollos. They were a blessing to many unknown believers that met in their house. But how many know, unfortunately, that isn't always the case? You move on to the book of 3 John. There's a man there by the name of Diotrephes. He's a power-hungry deacon. Where's our deacons here tonight? Just raise your hands. Good men right there, by the way. Praise God for our deacons. But this man was a power hungry, the Bible says, who always had to have the preeminence, meaning he always had to have first. He always had to be seen. He always had to be heard. And there are people like that in churches all over America today. You do it my way or else. I don't care if God wants in it or not. Tell him to take a back seat. And he was one who hurt the church rather than helped the church. But Aquila and Priscilla, they were a couple that was a blessing to the church, not a burden. And as we close, I think that's the question we all must ask ourselves. Am I helpful building the church? Am I helpful blessing the church? If we aren't, my suggestion is to simply follow the example given to us by two humble tent makers named Aquila and Priscilla. Let's bow our heads. You may be here tonight, you have a need in your life as we get a song of invitation. This was a message basically to the church, but you may be here tonight, you have a need in your life and you want to be remembered in prayer. God knows that need, He knows your heart, but you want to be lifted up in prayer. Would you just slip up your hand by that saying, pray for me?
Yes.
Bless those hands. God knows my heart, I need prayer tonight. God knows my life. Any other? Bless those hands. Any others? Any others? Bless those hands. I'm here tonight. You'd say, Will, more than anything, I want to be a blessing to this church. I want to help build this church. You raise your hand. I know you do. I know you do.
Yes.
You prove it through your faithfulness. I appreciate you. I love you. God bless all of you. Satan wants nothing more than to slither his way into this church and cause problems. And I pray that we would be wise. What does the Bible say? Wise as serpents.
Yes.
That we would love each other. The greatest thing this church can have is unity with one another as we grow and we build the kingdom together. God, we love you. We thank you for our church. Thank you for these people. Thank you for the blessings that they are to our church and how they help build this church. God, we love you and we thank you. I pray for those who raise their hand tonight. Lord, they have needs in their life and you know exactly what they are. And I pray that you would meet those needs. Help us as a church to do all we can to be an encouragement to them. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. As we stand together and sing, if you need to pray, the altars are open.
Page 410. Jesus, keep me near the cross.
Said This is a church that's trying to